If an ex-NASA administrator says that SLS will go away, you know that the endgame has started for that outdated taxpayer money waste of a monstrosity. So let's take a closer look at what Charlie Bolden had to say about SLS. Then let's of course also analyze the current developments at Boca Chica. And let's also talk about the upcoming Starship SN8 test flight.
Meanwhile, some environmental groups want to hinder SpaceX's progress at Boca Chica. In other news, NASA wants to pay private companies to gather moon rocks. The Omega rocket program got cancelled. And the new research shows a possible way to overcome the low gravity problem in space. And unfortunately, a rocket launch in China nearly ended in disaster. A lot to talk about, so stay tuned. The endgame for SLS has begun. If even an ex-NASA administrator says that SLS will go away, you know that opinion is really shifting against SLS on many different levels. Last week, Charlie Bolden, who was NASA administrator from 2009 to 2017, said during an interview on Politico, quote, SLS will go away. It could go away during a Biden administration or a next Trump administration, because at some point, commercial entities are going to catch up. They are really going to build a heavy lift launch vehicle, sort of like SLS, that they will be able to fly for a much cheaper price than NASA can do with SLS. That's just the way it works. Charlie Bolden speaks out loud what Jim Bridenstine is of course thinking, but not allowed to speak out loud as acting administrator. Namely that SLS is an overpriced relic from the past, long overdue, and very, very much over budget.
And if an ex-NASA administrator has such clear words against SLS, we are very sure that the eyes of more and more influential people will be opened about SLS in the near future. Bolden even mentioned a heavy lift vehicle, sort of like SLS, that will be a lot cheaper than SLS. So which heavy lift vehicle could he mean? New Glenn? Okay, sorry, that one has to be every time. Come on, it's kind of a running joke already. Of course we mean Starship. Starship will cost 1,000 times less per launch, and the crazy thing is, that's not even an exaggeration. Elon said that the final price per Starship Super Heavy launch is targeted to be around $2 million. Whereas we know that one single SLS launch costs $1.8 billion. So yes, 1,000 times more. But SLS can be launched only once per year. Yes, that's right. That's how many SLS can be produced, because as we know, the entire thing is thrown away after every launch. So, $2 billion per SLS for one launch per year. Starship, meanwhile, will be able to launch again on the same day. So it can fly hundreds of times more often than SLS per year. And we will have, as we know, many, many Starships. Thus, you can see why even Charlie Bolden starts to see that the SLS is really not a good idea anymore.
We have to understand that the development of SLS actually already began way back in 2005, when the Constellation program was announced. Back then, SpaceX hadn't even launched one single rocket into space yet. When Constellation got cancelled by Obama in 2010, the existing Ares rocket program was just transformed into the SLS program. In 2010, SpaceX launched the first Falcon 9 rocket into space. So it was still kind of reasonable to assume that SLS would be the most powerful heavy lift rocket for a long time. But after that, SpaceX just kept innovating and building larger and larger rockets, with Falcon Heavy launching in 2018 for the first time, which actually could already be used for moon landings. Of course, the politicians who control NASA still don't want to admit the truth and try to keep SLS alive. Because who built SLS? That's right, Boeing and Lockheed, the number one lobbyist companies in the spaceflight sector. So of course, they don't want Falcon Heavy to conduct moon landings a lot cheaper. But now, with the first real orbital Starship and Super Heavy flight, probably as soon as next year, support for SLS will start breaking away faster and faster. We prophesize that as soon as SpaceX successfully launches and safely lands a Starship with Super Heavy next year, the endgame for SLS will begin. The first SLS launch is scheduled for late 2021. But as we know, this is NASA language for probably 2022. So actually we believe that SLS will quite likely not fly even once. That's right, if SpaceX can make Starship and Super Heavy work reliably, then we are quite sure that SLS will get cancelled as early as 2022. Or 2023 at the latest. Certainly, if Starship's Dear Moon lunar round-trip mission with Yuzaku Maezawa in 2023 is successful, there's no chance anymore that SLS can still be kept alive. So yes, Charlie Bolden is completely right, and we're happy to see him speak loud what everyone else is thinking but not daring to say. And if you're new to our channel, please consider subscribing to us, because first, it's completely free. And second, it will tremendously help us to continue talking about space politics openly on this channel and to expose lobbyist companies like Boeing and Lockheed.
And if you don't believe us and think we're exaggerating again, which, okay, we sometimes might be doing, just look at Northrop Grumman's Omega rocket. This is the first one to go. The first legacy rocket builder to say bye-bye to its old-fashioned rocket. Because this rocket would have been obsolete anyways, thanks to Falcon Heavy and later Starship Super Heavy. But meanwhile, the culprit who is disrupting the entire spaceflight industry is being bombarded at Boca Chica. Some environmental groups say that SpaceX only has an FAA permission to launch Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy up to 12 times per year at Boca Chica. But because now Starship and Super Heavy are being developed and tested there, they say that a new environmental impact statement is necessary, which is more rigorous than the standard FAA environmental impact assessment. The FAA has given SpaceX permission to decide what type of environmental review to conduct. But of course, the so-called environmental groups are not happy with that and are urging the FAA to have them conduct an environmental impact statement, which would include public participation. They call themselves environmental groups, but how much damage do rocket launches actually cause for the environment? Everyday Astronaut did a really good estimation of rocket pollution, link in the description. Turns out that during a standard year, all rocket launches worldwide only account for 0.000059% of annual global CO2 emissions. You know, just saying. You know, there are more urgent things to protest against. For example, pollution from oil, huh? Oil spills. You know, coal power plants and so on. Why aren't they protesting against these things, huh? Just saying. One might even go as far as to say, those guys aren't real environmental groups, but that they might be sponsored by people who have a strong interest in hindering SpaceX and Starship development. Now who could those groups be?
Now finally, onto some more positive news from Boca Chica. Elon tweeted that SN8, complete with nose cone and flaps, should be done by the end of this week. Yes, this week. Then he said, we will see static fire, check out, another static fire, and then the 20 km high test flight, complete with skydiving and belly flop maneuvers, as visualized impressively here by Orbital Veg. This would be a gigantic step forward for the Starship program, and another nail in the coffin for SLS. Then the Super Heavy high bay roof construction has started now. So this building will soon be completed, that Super Heavy stacking can finally begin. And in this cool shot here by Mary, aka Boca Chica girl, we can see Starship SN5 next to SN6. What a spectacular sight to behold. Meanwhile, preparations are starting for the cryogenic proof testing of the SN7.1 test tank, which will be the first test of the new 304L stainless steel fabrication. This new steel is expected to perform better than the 301 steel because the welds should have a lot better cohesion at cryogenic temperatures. The cryogenic test can take place any day now, according to the latest Cameron County road closure dates. Now, in non-SpaceX related news, believe it or not, it does exist. NASA wants to pay private companies to gather moon rocks for them from the moon. These companies won't have to return the lunar soil samples back to Earth. Instead, NASA will gather them on site on the moon, quite possibly with astronauts who will return to the moon in 2024 with Starship. Yes, Starship, not SLS. Let's just hope that NASA will be smart enough to do so. Else, they might end up having to pay SpaceX to return the moon rocks for them from the moon. In other news, poor Catherine Koerner is now the new head of the Orion program at NASA. What a surprise! But again, no one wants to have this job, because everybody already secretly knows that the Orion program is as doomed as SLS, once Starship and Super Heavy flies. But we still congratulate her and wish her all the best. Maybe she can still keep Orion alive for a few more years.
Meanwhile, the Chinese show us impressively how not to launch a rocket. The first stage of a Long March 4B rocket, launched on September 7th, fell back to Earth and landed in a populated area, even worse, near a school, even more worse, releasing a cloud of toxic hydrazine. Yeah, this is what happens when you launch rockets inland, away from the sea, and use hydrazine as propellant for the first rocket stage. Fortunately, no one was injured or killed, but still, this is really uncool. Let's hope that China will learn to be more responsible with rocket launches. And now something completely different. We often talked about the problems future long-term settlers on the Moon or Mars might face because of the lower gravity there. Often we said that rotating habitats could be a solution to the problem, that create artificial 1G gravity by means of centrifugal rotation. Another solution we often mentioned was genetic engineering. Now, a new paper shows a way how this could be achieved quite easily, namely by inhibiting myostatin, a protein that limits muscle growth. Having big muscles proved evolutionary not very beneficial during hunger periods. That's why we humans have become so puny and weak, because all others who had big muscles died out during a bottleneck event around 70,000 years ago. This damn bottleneck event, because of that I have to go to the gym now 4 times a week. Anyways, so last year in December, 40 mice were launched to the ISS aboard SpaceX's CRS-19 cargo resupply mission. 8 of them were treated with a molecule that suppresses myostatin and activin A, another protein that inhibits muscle growth. After a few months, turns out that the normal mice lost significant bone and muscle mass, while the pumped-up mice actually gained bone and muscle mass, despite the zero-G environment. Consider us impressed. This could be the perfect solution to the low gravity problem, and at the same time, we could have brutal muscles. How cool is that? And a big part why SLS is so expensive are, of course, the solid rocket boosters by Northrop Grumman, which we bash in this video here.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future.
SLS is so expensive.
From the moon for now. Having to pay SpaceX